السلام عليكم ياسر.
السلام عليكم، شو بنو شو بس هايو جايز
وعليكم السلام ميس، we're fine. How are you
how
ميس؟
are you؟
الحمد لله I'm doing fine. So what about you, all of you? I hope you have submitted your results to Mr. Gulam.
Yes, miss. Yes, miss.
Yesterday was the deadline, isn't it?
I don't think there was any deadline. They just said
there was no deadline.
Okay.
There was no deadline.
But I hope you have already submitted, all of you.
Yes,
miss. Can I submit in the WhatsApp group, like to Mr. Gulam by WhatsApp?
No, you have to submit it in that email.
No, if you don't have your email, you can submit it over there, I think. He will be checking it every day.
Okay, but I don't know how to submit it in the email.
Okay, then in email, if you want to submit, you have to take a, like, you have to scan it and then send it to him, to email, like a file it will go. If you don't have that option, then you can send it through this one and inform him that, sir, I do not have that one. So I'm sending it all like this. I think he will check it. Inshallah. Okay, so today's class, what we are going to do? See, today is a different day for us, isn't it? If the school was there, we could have
yes.
had a celebration.
Yes, I wish you Shubha Navabarsha.
Thank you, dear. Shubha Navabarsha to all of you. And if the school was there, at least we could have had a small celebration and we could have wore special dress and all, right? Okay, it's okay because it's
Did you wear anything already or you're just dressing
No,
simply?
Dear. No, dear. In mind, I'm not feeling that fresh at this moment. Because we are worried,
okay.
right, about the situation and all. So,
True.
Don't have that intention from our mind. It's not coming. That freshness we don't have. We are kind of sad and all. So, we never thought that this world will be in this way. And, you know, after taking all the news and all, I really feel bad about And I feel kind of low as well, that what's going on, how is it possible that it's happening, and at which time it's going to be just like before again, and we are not sure, right? Okay, inshallah. So that's what I feel sometimes when I'm feeling really low, I just go to recite Quran, then it helps me a lot. Because there's nothing we can do, right? Only to, rather than just praying to Allah to save us from all these disasters. Okay, yes, inshallah. He will listen to us, inshallah, because we love him a lot. At the same time, he is also going to save us from all the problems that we have around us.
Oh,
Nihat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's the only one whom we can pray, isn't it? We should pray all the time because this is a situation that is happening to us. We never thought of it. In my age also, even from my parents also, I never heard that anything happened like that in their lifetime. So you can understand how difficult it is for us to check it. Of course, you are in a very early age, so you are also experiencing. Who knows, you will be telling your future generation regarding this thing that we had in our lifetime. It is very, very isn't it? Okay, guys. Now, tell me, yesterday we were doing, I think we are done with this 63, right? October, November 19th. 63, October, November 19th. And Anika, I'll be checking your papers today and then I'll give you the information, right? So, shall I?
Okay, miss, no problem.
Yeah, no problem. I'll do that. Okay. So, shall I go back to 42, October, November? I think
yes.
we're doing, right? Did I finish 42 already?
We're doing 42. No, we were doing 43, right?
40. I'm not sure. That's what I'm asking you. Did I finish 42 with you? Completely?
I'll just check this. Just
a yeah, have a look. Whether I have finished 42, I don't remember. No result in moment.
Yes, we were in 43. 43, 40. October, November 19.
We'll be just starting that one, right?
Bring question number 7.
Or we did some of them. Oh, yeah, I did yesterday, I remember. Question number 7. Okay, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, now you just tell me question number 6. It was about the sound wave. Did I complete that question? The sound wave question?
Which year?
That is 43, October, November 19. Did I complete question number 6 with you girls? Could you just check and tell me?
Yes,
Or is it like, I mean, question number 4 or 5? I'm actually not sure. Because yesterday I went to 62, 63 variants. I forgot how much I did. Oh, yeah, I remember, girls. Okay, now Anika, okay, I actually finished till question number 4 yesterday, I remember. 42
yes, you did. Miss.
Yeah,
question
so
five
we,
now.
Exactly. We were supposed to start question number 5. Fine. So, all of you, just open that page. That is page number 7, 43, October, November 19. That is question number 5. It's a thermal physics question. Okay, so we are going to do this. So let's take what is the question about. An electric kettle contains water at a temperature of 90 degrees Celsius. 19 means that is the room temperature. The kettle has a power rating of 3 kilowatt and is switched on for 3.5 minutes. Calculate the energy supply to the kettle by the electrical supply or electricity supply. So what would be the equation that we'll be using here? They have given us the power, the time.
Temperature, PT, E equals PT.
Yeah, fine. That is the correct equation. E equals to PT. And they have given us the time in minute. You're supposed to convert that one to second. Okay.
Yes,
so, and one more thing, the power is
3 kilowatt will be three,
exactly.
We have to take 3 kilowatts.
Yes, yes. You have to convert kilowatt to watt as well. So, check what's the final answer coming up. E equals to PT, then it will become 3 multiplied by 1000.
Miss, is it 630,000
yes,
joules?
Yes, fine. That means you can make it 6.3 into 10 to the power 5 joules.
Okay.
If you go to the standard form, then 6.3 into 10 to the power 5 joules. Then, Nihal, do you have the paper with you in front of you?
Yes, teacher.
Okay. Did you get the answer?
No.
Do you have your calculator with you here? You should have it in front of you. Now, please and check the answer whether you got it or not. And Nihal, did you submit your results?
Yes.
Good. Now let's go for. Shall I go to part B of the question?
Yes, miss.
Okay. In 3.5 minutes, the temperature of the water reaches 100 degrees Celsius. Means it was at 19 degrees Celsius, from there it moved to 100 degrees Celsius. The volume of the water is given and the density is also given. The specific capacity of water they gave in kilograms. Did you notice all the changes in the unit? There they have given us the volume and the density in CBS.
We'll find the mass by using the density equation, mass by volume, and it will change to density into volume. And then we go for energy equals MC delta theta.
Fine, but you have to remember, if you go for that rho equals to M by V equation, you'll be getting the value of mass in gram. So you have to divide by 1000 to convert to kg. And after that, you're using it in E equals to MC delta. Okay. Now take it and then you do it and then show me the result. Okay, by the time I want to talk to Alia. Alia, you have given your results. Did you submit your result? Okay, Alia, Orfa, Nuzaima, Zareen. I hope all of you have submitted your result. Okay. Alia, when will you submit? You're supposed to submit it quickly. So do it. Anytime today, you just submit. What's the problem? Why didn't you submit till now? You don't have your results?
Excuse me, miss?
Yes, Anika?
Is the answer 714 and then followed by 4 zeros?
No, dear. I think you made a mistake. Have a look. Okay, first you tell me M, mass. How much you got the mass?
Oh, mass, is it 17?
Okay. 17, no. It was supposed to be 1.7 kg. I told you, you have to divide by 1000.
Oh, yes.
Kg. I think
sorry, you forgot sorry, that. Sorry, I divided by 100 and that went wrong.
Yeah. Correct.
Yes, it's 1.7.
Okay. From there, you just do the next. E equals to MC delta again. You check us.
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
I can see that Zarin said already she submitted. Okay. I'm a private student and they didn't tell me. Alia, when did you become a private student? I didn't know that. Alia? I thought you were a regular student. I didn't know that you were a private student. you were joining, you were attending the school all the time. Then how come you became a private student? Oh, I didn't know that. Okay, fine. You might be having a different rules and regulations for you. I'm not sure about that. Okay, leave it. Yes, I'm fine. Okay.
Miss, is the answer 7.14 multiplied by 10 to the power 5?
I didn't think so. Delta theta, look, MC. You got M is 1.7. Specific heat capacity is 4,200. And the delta theta is 100 minus 19, change in temperature. Then check the answer. Okay, Aliya, we are doing 43 October November 19, question number 5. 43 October November 19, question number 5, I'm doing. Okay. Is this Samia Bint Shahid? She wants to join my class, or is this someone else? I'm not sure. Okay, guys. Now listen. So, Anita, you are supposed to get the answer around 5.78 × 10⁵ joules. 5.78 × 10⁵
Am I supposed to use 19 degrees Celsius?
No, dear. Delta theta means change in temperature. So it has to be 100 minus 19. Change in temperature. Not only one. You have to subtract and temperature rises.
Now I got the good answer. It's like 713981, right?
What are you saying here? I got it. Let me just check it again. I got it 5.78 × 10⁵. Even though I just go through one more time. So it's 1.7 × 10⁰.
Yes, yes, wait. I got 578340.
Fine. That's the correct answer. So you just, if you want, you can transfer that one to the standard form. 5.78 × 10⁵ joules. Correct.
Yes, yes.
Okay, now. Let's go to calculate the efficiency of the kettle. So you'll be writing the equation first of all. Efficiency equals useful energy output divided by total energy.
Total energy input multiplied by 100.
Multiplied by 100%. Yes, that is the one. Okay. Fine. Now, check what is the value that we got here. They say, okay, initially we got 6.3 × 10⁵. That is our input, and the output you got right now. Then check, what's the answer coming up?
5.8 × 10⁵, right?
Yes, and divided by 6.3 × 10⁵ joules, 5 again. And then multiply by
91.8.
Yes, I think it is correct. So if you want, you can go to 92% as well. Okay. Now let's go to question number 6. Okay. Now in question number 6, if you just look at it, they have given us a wave pattern, that is a sound wave. And of course, sound wave is nothing but a longitudinal wave. And they gave us the pattern, and they're asking us to on the diagram, we have to do something, that is state the name given to the region around A in the diagram. So if you just look at the diagram, can you tell me what we should give the name to A?
Compression.
I think it is correct. It is compression. And then we have a region around B, that is rarefaction. Yes, that's correct. Then look, part B of the question, they say, on the figure, draw a double-headed arrow to show one wavelength. So
it's we from one rarefaction to another rarefaction, or one compression to another compression.
Fine, very good. So do it like that. Okay. So you'll be drawing a straight line, giving arrow in both the directions to enclose it. That's for double-headed arrow. And then highlight it, that is the one you're asking for one single wave. Then the loudness of the sound increases at the same pitch. Okay, now What is the page, girls? I forgot actually. Could you remind me what is the page? Anyone from the class? What is the page?
Proportional FAQ, right? Pitch was equal to amplitude stuff?
No, yeah. Pitch is not.
So pitch is the frequency
stuff, right?
It is the frequency.
It is the shrillness, right, miss?
Shrillness is the sensation. Right, we cannot measure it, but it is actually related to the frequency. The more the frequency, then the more the pitch. That is the one. Okay, fine. So now they're saying, Skating explained any change there would be in the pattern of the waveform shown in the figure. But what did he? They increases the loudness, but the pitch remains the same. Okay, now you tell me one thing. When they increase the loudness, which quantity of the wave is getting changed? When you increase the loudness, which quantity of the wave gets changed?
The amplitude. Amplitude.
Yes. The amplitude will increase because we have increased the loudness. So fine. Now they are asking that we have to explain the changes that will happen in the pattern of the waveform. Okay. First of all, as the loudness is getting increased, so the waveforms will be coming closer together, more packed it will become in the compression, and in case of rarefaction, they'll go further apart. This is due to the increase of loudness. Okay. And in amplitude increases, but even they said one more thing, but wavelength and frequency remains the same. We have to mention. So first thing we'll be discussing is that as the loudness is getting increased, the waveforms will come closer together and at compression. Of course, in compression, we're talking about that one. And then in rarefaction, they'll move further apart. Okay. And as the at the same time, we'll explain this one also that since the frequency remains the same, because they said the same pitch, so if you mention it, as the pitch remains the same, so frequency is constant as well. Clear? Then, shall I proceed to this part of D? Hello, are you following me, girls? Okay, so I want to go to part D of the question. The wave passes into water. Okay. Before it was in the air, now it is in the water. Okay. They can explain any change in the pattern of waveforms shown in the paper. Okay. First of all, I want to ask you the question. If the wave is going to water, what will be the change of the sound wave in water? It was in air.
Speed will increase. Wavelength will increase.
Yes, definitely. Speed will increase. Wavelength will increase. Frequency remains the same. So we just mentioning the speed of sound is greater. Okay, by the way, do you remember what is the amount of speed in water? Amount of the speed of sound wave in water?
1500 meter per second,
definitely. Okay, so we can write it like this, that the speed of sound is greater in water than in air. So wavelength increases and the waveforms spread out more. As the wavelength is going to increase, so the waveforms will be moving away from each other. They're asking about the pattern, so if you mention it, the wave fronts are spreading more than before, or spread out more than before. Then first, can I go to the next question? That is number 7. It is a lens question. Okay, now let's take what we have here. In 7.1, in figure 7.1, the position of a converging lens, its principal axis, and an object is shown. Okay, fine. Each principal axis of the lens is labeled as F. Okay. On the figure, draw a ray diagram to locate the position of the image formed by the lens. Now, if you just look at the pattern, what do you expect the diagram should be? Anyone? What do you expect the diagram should be? Will it be a real image? Will it be a virtual image?
To be the same side as the object.
First of all, you need to decide, is it a real image or a virtual image that is going to form here?
Real?
No, it is a virtual image. This is the first time when you are keeping an object in between the optical center and principal focus, you will be getting a virtual image. And the image is going to form on the same side of the lens as the object. Okay, because the two refracted waves will never meet each other. We have to trace them back, and then we'll find that they're going to meet each other at a particular point. So definitely that is the point where you're going to expect the tip of the object is going to form. Now they're asking, describe the nature of this image I. So could you tell me what are the image, what are the nature of this particular image? Already we said it's a virtual image. If you just look at the, if you draw the diagram, you can understand it will be
enlarged.
Upright, enlarged, upright.
Enlarged.
Fine. Virtual, upright, enlarged. And if you want, you can add that one also, that it formed at the same side of the lens as the object. Altogether four natures we are going to write down here. Done? Shall I move? Okay. Now you check C of the question. Image is formed by lenses sometimes have colored edges. Okay. So they're asking. Yeah, Anika, did you finish the part of question number 7A that I discussed right now?
Yes, 7A. 7A, okay. We finished it.
This is the image that you're going to get for a virtual image. Because the object, if you look at it, it is placed in the middle of the principal focus and the optical center.
Excuse me, miss.
Yes, dear.
Miss, would you mind telling C, 6C and D again? Because I got disconnected and I couldn't see.
Okay, fine. So let me repeat quickly. 6C. The wavefronts are closer together at compressions.
Mm.
And further apart at rarefactions.
Okay.
As loudness increases, amplitude increases, but wavelength and frequency remains the same. But wavelength and frequency remains the same.
Okay.
Now part D, they said here, let me quickly give you, that is the speed of sound is greater in water than in air. The speed of sound is greater in water than in air. So wavelength increases and waveforms spread out more than before. Spread out more than before.
More than the?
More than before. Okay, because it is going from air to water now. Okay.
Okay.
Now, number 7A, you're welcome here. 7A, the diagram you can draw because it is in our copy book. You can draw it, the last diagram that we have. And B is, describe the nature of the image. I, that is a virtual, upright.
Virtual and in upright.
Enlarged, upright, altogether. And then part C, I was doing. Images formed by the lenses sometimes have colored edges. Okay, they're asking why we do have a colored edge, the reason behind it. First of all,
focus?
No, failure. It is about the dispersion of light. That happens in the, because we learned that for dispersion, we need a denser medium. At that time, the prism was acting like a medium that is going to disperse the light, means it's going to break the light into different colors. Here, you know that. The lens is also made up of glass and it has a certain thickness. So that is why it is going to disperse. So you can write that different color lights at different frequency and wavelength. So dispersion occurs in the glass lens. First of all, dispersion, why dispersion occurs? Because different colors have different frequency and wavelength. Different color light, yes. Different color lights have different frequency and wavelength. So dispersion occurs in glass lens. Okay. Now you go to question number 8. If you just look at it, it is actually a static electricity question. Yeah, it is a static electricity question. First you just check, they said they have given us a negatively charged conducting sphere. Draw the electrical field pattern around the sphere. Okay, I want Nihar, could you tell me what will be the pattern of this electric field around the negatively charged sphere? Nihar, are you following my class? Could you tell me the answer of this question? Nihar, are you there? Okay, I think she's not here. Okay, anyone else who can give me this answer? That when you are having...
charge, the plus signs around the ball.
Yes, you are going to draw the lines that is coming out of the one we call aerial lines, we call it. And what about the arrow that you're going to place to show the direction? Nihat, I couldn't hear you. Yet.
Miss, the arrows will be towards the circle?
Yes, it will be inwards. Towards the circle or inwards? No, Nihat, I couldn't hear you. Okay, fine. Next one we'll be doing. So you'll be drawing the lines that is called aerial lines coming out from the sphere. But the arrows has to be inwards because it is a negatively charged sphere. Okay, now okay. Yes. The current in an electrical device is 0.21 ampere. Calculate the charge that flows during a 75 second period of time. Fine. So you know the formula how charge, current, and time yes. relate each other.
Current equals charge by time.
No, dear. Oh, current equals to charge by time. That is correct. I equals to Q by T or Q equals to IT. So they're asking us to find out the charge. So we go with Q equals to IT.
Okay.
The current they have given to us 0.21 multiplied by the time 75 seconds. Okay, shall I proceed? Is it done? What's the answer, girls?
Forced.
How much
this
is that?
15.7, isn't it?
15.7, okay.
15.75 coulomb?
Yeah, fine. Or you make it 15.8 coulomb, then you can convert that one to 16 coulomb. Because, you know, charge cannot be a decimal, so we can go to the next number, 16 coulomb, round it up. To two digits, too significant. Okay, so it is 16. Now, I want you to check question number 9. It is actually an electronics as well as a current electricity together. There is both of things together here. Just check. They gave us a figure. On the figure, there is an LED. There are two resistors which are connected in parallel. Okay, there is an electrical source. Some cells are connected. It became a battery. Okay, fine. Now they're asking the normal operating voltage for the LED is 2.1 volt and the normal current is 0.19 ampere. Okay, now A1 is the potential difference across the LED is measured with a voltmeter. On the figure, draw the symbol for the voltmeter connected to the circuit. Okay, now Anika, as you are following my class, I want you to tell me how will you connect voltmeter there? Because we are going to measure the PV across LED. Is she there? I'm not sure. Okay. Who else is there? Nizama, are you there? Nizama? Nizama, Zaleen, Rahma, are you there?
Yes, miss, but I don't have it in front of me.
Okay. Okay, fine. Yes, someone gave me answer. Let me have a look. Yeah, very good. It is a very good answer, very. It has to be in parallel across the LED. Means, after R, there's no point that is there. Something you can just extend and draw the voltmeter symbol and connect it across the LED. That's correct answer. After that, we say, the current in the LED is measured with an ammeter. On the figure, draw the symbol for this ammeter connected to the circuit. Okay.
The we'll just the fill that gap with that ammeter, drawing at that ammeter.
Yes, you can do that. We just draw the symbol of an ammeter and fill that gap. That's it. Correct. Okay. Now, look at this page here. Calculate the value of R when the LED is operating normally. Okay.
We'll follow the parallel resistor equation.
Yes, you'll come to that, but first we'll check what to find out the PV. Means they already gave us. Okay. Before that, you understand.
Is it 3.5?
Which one, yeah?
No, the answer is 3.5?
For B?
Yes.
Are you telling me the final answer? Because it has certain take 5 months they gave you. Are you giving me the final answer?
Yes.
Then you are not right there. Just hold on, let us read together. First, TB okay. across the resistance. Okay. They say here, look first, you check the diagram one more time. The two are connected in parallel. Again, they are connected in series with the element, isn't it? If you explain the circuit, so we can say that whatever the 2R is going to experience from the source, that will be actually added with the LED to go to the main circuit. So let us find out PD across the resistors first of all. Altogether, the source was providing to us 3.7. So 3.7 minus 2.1, the one which is getting which is taken by the LED. Okay, subtract that. Then we find out what is the voltage across.
Get 1.6 volt.
Okay, fine. Leave it.
1.6 volt.
Fine. Done. So now let's go for the combined resistance of these two. So what is our equation? 1/RP equals to 1/R1 plus 1/R2. Here we don't have any value for R's, but we can consider them as R as well. So equals to, we can write 1/R plus 1/R equals to 2/R. Can I do that?
Yes.
Yes, fine. So RP is becoming, if you reciprocal it, it will become R/2. So your RP is R/2. Okay. Now we'll go back to Ohm's law. That is B equals to IRP. B equals to IR, but I'm using here RP because they are connected in parallel. So B equals to IRP. So RP.
So 1.6 equals 0.19 multiplied by RP. R/2.
Let me see here. What are we doing here? RP equals to V/R. So your voltage is 1.6. But did you notice on the top, they gave us the normal current. When it is a series circuit, current remains the same. So that 0.19 will be here as a deviation. I said yes. RP here. Yes. So what is the answer coming up here? 1.6 divided by 0.19. Because the same current will flow to the resistors as well as the LED. Because that can be detected.
It is 8.4 ohm.
8.4 or something more is there.
Sorry, miss?
Do you have more decimal numbers?
Yes, we do. It's 8.42.
42. Okay, then keep it 8.42 ohm. Okay. Now, the next step is that already we have calculated RP is R/2. So I will write R/2 equals to 8.42. Then R equals to cross multiply 8.42 multiplied by 2.
Miss, it's 16.84.
Mm-hmm. Okay, fine. You can keep it, or if you want, you can go to the next number, that is
17 ohm.
Yes, you can go to that. Our next question, that is question number 10, it is, you can say, it is actually electromagnetism question. Question number 10, electromagnetism. So, all of you turn the page, those who are having with you at this moment, turn the page and check. Question number 10, what do we have? Okay, I can see Amina joined us. Amina, did you send your results? Amina, did you send your result to Mr. Gulam?
No, miss, I did not.
Why do you have to?
I just
yes?
No, miss, what were you saying?
No, I'm saying you were supposed to send it, right? All of you should send the results to me as soon as possible. Isn't it? Okay.
Miss, I'm going to send tomorrow, by inshallah.
Okay. But make sure you're sending it. Otherwise, you will not have any supporting for your prediction. Okay. And as the school is now, it's kind of difficult for anyone to contact with others without any paper. If the school was open anytime, we can open the closet and we can find out all the files and all the things. Okay. Now, all of you go to that question 10, 43, October number 19. A magnet and a coil are attached separately to others. Okay. If you just look at it, the coil is actually attached to the frame, door frame, and the magnet is attached to the door. Okay, so they are two different situations. And the coil itself is connected to, on the door frame, the coil which is connected, it is connected to an indicator. Okay, now who can give me the name of this indicator they have used over here?
Oh, that's a light emitting diode.
Yes, it is in connection of the question as well. And when the arrows are outside, we call it light emitting diode. Fine. Okay, now just check what happened over the indicator. Okay. The purpose of the arrangement is to activate a circuit connected to an LED indicator when the door is opening or closing. Means, I think about in my room, I have this door. So when it is open and closed, I can see it due to the light. But first, tell me one thing. Rather than the LED, can I have something else which can prove this circuit or this system more effective for me? Could you replace with some other device in place of this indicator light, which can prove this system more effective to any person who's
can use variable resistor?
Why do you use the variable resistor? What is the purpose of this indicator? I need to first understand that.
Well, it varies the resistor. Oh, we don't need the resistor here.
No, not at all. The indicator LED is actually going to warn the person who's inside the room that someone is getting in or getting out by opening the door. Isn't it?
Thermistor.
No, really, dear. Can I ask
so, miss, we can use light dependent resistor.
Why would you use LDR here? I don't need any resistor. Can I use a buzzer? Because I might be writing, my eye is not on the indicator light, so I will not be able to see whether the light is on or off. But rather than a buzzer is there, or an electric bell, then it will help me, isn't it? Even if I'm not looking at the indicator, I'm doing some work, writing or something, I'm doing some writing work. Welcome back, girls. Could you hear me? Hello, girls.
Hello, miss.
Yeah. So let's continue with that question number 10, the one I was doing with you. So let's check what was that. I was telling you that I can easily have a buzzer or an electric bell so that it will ring out whenever a person is going to open the door or close it. So that without looking at that indicator light also, I will be aware of the situation. Okay. So now take the next part of the question. They say here what to do. That initially the door is closed. Okay. Initially the door is closed and then it is open. Okay. Explain why the indicator comes on and then goes off when the door is open. Okay. Now, if first of all, you tell me one thing, guys. What is the purpose of the magnet and the coil over there? Why we have to keep them like this? And if we keep it, then what is the purpose behind it? What we are expecting to get? Or one more thing, girls, did you notice from the coil to the indicator, then indicator to the coil, right? Do we have an electrical source in that particular case? Do we have, first you analyze the circuit, then it will be easy for you to give the answer of this particular question. Do you find any electrical source in that particular circuit of the coil and the indicator LED? Do we have? I don't think so. Right, girls? Okay. If it is not there, then we can understand that there has to be somewhere we are doing something that is going to produce some electricity that will allow the indicator light to beat. Isn't it? So, what could be done? Yes, girls, what could be done? That is, when we are going to open the door, then what is happening? The movement. Yes, 1 minute, I need you. Okay, the coil will cut the magnetic fields, which will generate an EMF in the wire. So that, yes, fine. Yes, I thank you. That's a good answer. That is what it is happening there. Means when we are going to open the door, the movement of the magnet makes the field lines cut by the coil, and then induces EMF that makes the LED on. But why will it go off? Because as soon as the door moved out, means if the magnet is not below the coil, so that time there will be no cutting of magnetic field lines, so the LED will go off. That's the mechanism. Means as when the door was closed, the magnet is just immediately below the coil. So when you opened it, that time the magnetic field lines got cut by the coil. And a small amount of EMF is going to produce. That EMF will allow the indicator light to lead or to light up. Then after that, when it moved away, that time this magnet is not below the coil, so there will be no cutting of magnetic field lines And then there'll be no longer, that's why they say that it got on, it comes on and then goes on. That's it. When that time means when you moved it away from the coil, that time this indicator light is going to be operating. Clear? Okay. Now let's go to the next part of the question, that is 10A2. The door shuts, the indicator comes on more brightly, but for a shorter time than it did in one. Suggest and explain you this answer or why this happens. Okay, so if you just look at it, they say that you're going to shut the door. Okay, now just imagine the door closed more quickly. I think they mentioned it somewhere over here. Let me see. The indicator comes on more brightly. Oh, as the indicator came more bright, so we can expect that actually the door was closed very quickly, because the more the rate of cutting of magnetic field lines got increased here. So we have to say that as the door closed more quickly and then it is open, so more rate of cutting of magnetic field lines produces higher current and the magnet moves for a short time. As the magnet moves for a short time, because as soon as the magnet goes inside the door, is inside the door frame, that time there will be no movement of the magnet and no magnetic field lines will be cut. That is why we are saying it became brighter for a shorter time than part one of the answer. So the main point is that as it came out bright, it means that the door was closed more quickly than it was open. More rate of cutting of magnetic field lines produces a higher current. Clear, girls? Okay, fine. Now let's go to part B of the question. Mm-hmm. That is, a circuit breaker is recommended for use with an electric lawnmower. With an electric lawnmower, that is two reasons. Reasons for this recommend. Oh, I think is this the same thing? Yeah, it's the same thing. I thought it's from the other part of the question. No, it's about a circuit. It's about a circuit breaker. Okay, a circuit breaker is recommended for use with an electric lawnmower. Now we have to say what is the purpose of using a circuit breaker with a lawnmower. So, do you remember what is the purpose of using a circuit breaker in a circuit? Do you remember that, girls? Is there anyone who can give me any advantage or any reason why to use a circuit breaker in a lawnmower? Or any other appliances? It can be any other electrical appliances. Why we do place a circuit breaker? Isn't it to protect against overheating and electric shock or any electrical accident? So that one you can write. It protects against overheating and electric shock. So another one is that you can say that it prevents a damage to the lawnmower. That is why all the time we do use a circuit breaker or an electric fuse to protect your appliances from getting damaged by the higher amount of electricity. Isn't it?
Yes.
Okay. You got disconnected, Anika. I haven't heard you for a certain time.
Yes, miss.
Okay, fine.
I was trying to connect, but then I don't know, some problem with connection.
Yeah, it's a technical problem. It can happen anytime. Okay. Now let's go to question number 11. That is the last question of 43 October number 19. Okay, check. Okay. Here the circles, if you look at the diagram, the circles shown represents three gold nuclei, three alpha particles are approaching the gold nuclei, and then you have to complete the path of them. So if you just place your scale, you see the first alpha particle is just falling. Yes, it is falling on the top of the nucleus. So definitely it has to bounce back. Second one is kind of very close. So what path you're going to draw?
Well, the second one will go straight because it's not that close to the nucleus.
No,
is it?
Yeah, it is close. So you draw it and it will go upwards. It will bend upwards.
Oh, yes, it will go upwards.
Yes, right. It's a force of repulsion. Now look at the third one. It is an alpha particle. If you draw, it is also going close. No, dear, it will also not go straight. If you just draw, it goes very close. So it will go downwards because force of repulsion. That is the purpose that they gave us this question. One will go upwards, second one, third one is also closed, then it will go downwards. Because upwards of the puppet is going to work.
Okay.
Now you check the next part of the question. It's a half-life question. Okay.
Yes.
A detector of radioactivity in the laboratory indicates an average of 16 pounds per minute when no radioactive samples are present. So what do we call this reading? Girls,
well, background reading.
It's a background radiation. Fine. Then they say here, okay, a radioactive sample of half-life 1.5 days is placed close to the detector, which indicates a count rate of 208 pounds per minute.
Okay.
Okay. Now we have to go for to calculate the count rate that is indicated 6 days later.
Okay.
So they have given us the count rate on the detector. So let us find out the true source count initially. How will we do that? True source count. 208.
First,
then?
Yes.
You have to subtract.
First, minus 16. 208.
Yes, correct.
192.
192 counts per minute. From there, you start going for half life, means 192, put an arrow, first half life, then 192 by 2. Keep on doing it, and how many half life are you supposed to get? 6 days.
We have to do it 6 times?
1, 2, 3. I think it is 4 times. 6 days, so 1.5 day multiplied by 4 will give us 6 days. So go for 4
yes,
half life. Yes, and then tell me what is the count rate you are leaving?
The final answer. Means the final answer is 28?
Yes, correct. But what was the count rate you got initially? After
it's 12. Plus 16. 28 plus 16.
Not 28, dear. You're
12 plus 16.
Yes, 12 yes, plus 16. That's correct, yeah. After
it's 28.
4 half-life, you will be having 12 counts per minute in your hand. Then you have to add background radiation, that is 16 with it, then you will end up with 28 counts per minute. Okay. Now, that's the last part of the question. The waste from nuclear power station includes the isotopes titanium-99, T-136 and solanium-79. These isotopes are radioactive with half-lives of many thousands of years. Oh, the state three economic and environmental consequences of producing these waste. Okay. Did you notice that the half-life is so high? A huge half-life of thousands of years. Okay, so definitely it will be producing some kind of hazards in the environment as well as the human life, or as well as the animals, all the animals or the living creatures that we have in the world. So,
and then this, we also have that lead shielding storage, like high cost of lead shielding
yes, storage. It is there. But you have to manage this waste in a way so that it should not come in touch with the environment. So, then we need a lead line container definitely. Okay, and while we are
it can
doing,
cause cancer.
No, definitely it is. But what we are going to say about here is that economic. They say three, economic and environmental consequences. So we can do one thing, we can give two economic and one environmental consequences. First of all, as we said, you already mentioned about the lead line container, which is really going to be expensive.
It's loss of farming lands?
Not really, we're not going to put it on the ground, right? So first thing is that it is going to have
pollution of atmosphere.
That is the environment. So first we can say about that the waste must be stored safely in a lead line shielding, which is expensive. Okay. And again, when we are going to transport it, means the nuclear power station from there, we have to send it somewhere, right? So when we are transporting it also, we have to have thick lead shielding, which can also be very expensive. Okay. And if it escapes to the environment due to any other reason, it can be very dangerous to the people and to the nature. So that will be the environmental damage that or consequence. Right, guys? First of all, of course, if you want to dump it somewhere also, and since it is having a very long half-life, we have to ensure that we are putting it inside a lead line container and we're going to dump it deep under the earth. We have to make a huge hole, digging a deep hole, and then we're going to dump it and cover it with the earth again. So we have to do that. For that also it is expensive, and we have to take it to a land or to a place where people do not live very close. And then we can dump it deep inside the earth. And finally, that is the one I say, that if it escapes to the earth, think about the person who dumped it, didn't dig a hole very deep. So that time there's a chance that due to rainwater or due to any other reason, it can come to the surroundings, and that might cause a huge problem, or it could be very dangerous for any other person within the world as well as by nature. Okay, guys. I want to ask you, I want to share something with you. Is there anyone who watched the movie Radioactivity in this group? Anyone?
Radioactive.
Radioactivity. There's a movie on the life of Marie Curie. Okay, that day I was checking the movie review, and I'm planning to watch that movie today or tomorrow, because I found it very interesting, because they showed her full life in that movie. Okay, so if you have chance, I want you to watch that movie. I think you can go to the YouTube and check it.
What's the name of the movie again, Miss?
Radioactivity. I hope it's going to be
I actually watched Theory of Everything, like Stephen Hawking's, and a...
Even I watched that, and then I watched the Pandemic, part one and part two, both the movies. Lately, I was watching all those. So I was planning, I should have seen the movie review of that movie, Radioactivity. Just because it's only on the life of Madame Curie, I got interested. So I'm planning to watch the movie today or tomorrow, very soon, inshallah.
Okay, I'll watch it now.
Yeah.
After the classes.
After the class. But first, you have to have your lunch, pray, Zohar prayer, and then. Even I'm planning to watch
the whole
movie.
Thing, and then I'll watch the movie.
Yeah, true. Because these are informative movies, and especially you'll be able to know about the struggle she has gone through while having these practices and all. And I told you, right, a small about her personal life disaster she has gone through due to the Second World War and all this stuff, how it influenced her life and all. So I hope it's going to be a very interesting movie. I want to watch that. Okay, guys. So I think today we have finished all the 2019 questions, right, girls? Okay. So now you tell me next week what we should do. What is your plan? What do you want me to do with you next week? Is it like we can discuss about some topics, or what do you want me to do with you? Because before I remember, 2018, almost all the question papers I have solved with you. Only this 2019 paper was left with us, so I did it with you. I think we took around 3 weeks. So, alhamdulillah, we are done with it. So, now what is your idea? Then, how we could use the next few days of class that we have with us?
For the next class, can we revise motion graphs as I've asked before?
Yeah, that we can do. And any other?
We can revise our doubts.
Yeah, we can do that. So, particular topic we can start and discuss. But it's a 1 hour class, so I think we can do a little bit more on that particular class next Sunday. I have a class with you next Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. So, those 3 days.
Miss, can we do some paper two?
Yeah, we can do that. Which one? Okay, then we can do one thing. Let's start with 2019. That day, I will discuss with you motion graph initially. And then I will check with you paper 2 of 2019, because we have 6 variants there. So we can try that. And you know, some of the paper 2 questions are kind of, you have to go through the calculation and reach the answer.
Exactly.
Yes, there you have to have a very clear idea about all the conceptions, as well as all the topics that we have in your syllabus. At the same time, you have to do the calculation. Sometimes you have to go for 2-step calculation, 3-step calculation. Then only you reach the answer.
And the mark is only 1.
And the time is 1 minute. And you know what? In Excel level also, you'll be having the pattern of physics question papers like that. Every question paper, you have some multiple choice on the same paper. Then you have paper 4 questions. Just like we have 2 and paper 4, the pattern of the question, you will get them combined in unit 1 and unit 2. In physics, like you know, grade 11, you'll be studying 3 papers, unit 1, 2, and 3. Unit 1 and 2 will have the same pattern of question, means on the same paper, you'll be getting some MCQ question and a paper 4 type of question. Means there'll be a definition, there'll be a calculation, there'll be some explanation question, and some asterisk questions are also there. The equation, the questions are like that, they'll be checking your English punctuation in that question. and they will give a star on that, and they call it asterisk question. Okay, and unit 3 is just like the paper 6 we do in IGCSE. Similar, there will be some questions that will be given to you, that will be given to you, and you will get some answers, just like we do in paper 6. And before, we used to have a planning question in unit 3 and unit 6. Now they discarded that pattern of the question, but the other questions are there. Means there will be a pattern of the question. They'll ask you to measure and find out the answer the way you do in paper 6, the other questions. So it's like that. So it means that in if you are proceeding with physics or any other subject, because all the subjects have the same pattern, you have three units on grade 11, that is AS, and A2, you're going to have to gain 3 units. And 3 units, you'll be having unit 4, 5, and 6. 4, 5 is just like unit 1 and 2, and unit 6 and unit 3 is similar, that is alternative to practical. Like that will be happening. Inshallah. Once you step in the school with the syllabus, it will be easy for you, and you can decide your mind what to do and how to do and everything. Okay. As Amina is there, I want to ask Amina. Amina, are you thinking about your A level? What are the subjects you'll be taking? Are you giving any thought about it?
Miss what?
Miss A level. What are the subjects you'll be taking? Have you given any thought
about it? Miss, I'm not taking physics in grade 11.
Okay, fine. And then what are the subjects you're planning to take?
Miss, I'm planning to take accounting, computer, maths, and English.
About the thing I have said about that English, Miss Kishwar said that she doesn't offer the school doesn't offer English A levels anymore.
Yeah, I told you like that a few years back, like around 4 to 5 years back.
You're right about it.
Yes, 4 to 5 years back, we had one student only. That was the last student we had. And in fact, that girl is now studying honors in English in Dhaka University. That girl. I remember her name, she was Maya Mola. She was a good student.
So that leaves you with my science subjects and math. We have no English. We do have it in school, but then the science subjects and
It's up to you, whatever subjects you're taking, but English they don't offer anymore. She was our last student.
Not available.
Yes. Okay, fine, because you've got time now, and you have to wait for the result coming up from the Cambridge University.
Yes, things even depend on the result as well.
Exactly. And by the time you can discuss with your parents, and you can even discuss with you yourself, okay, yes. What I'm comfortable with, what should I do, and what are the aspects of this particular subject, what where they are going to lead me. So all this you can think about. And you can even, by the time you can even check some of the universities' brochure, like what are the subjects they want, and if you study these three subjects or 4 subjects, what are the aspects that are there for you? What are the subjects you can study afterwards? So you have enough time, and since you're using it nowadays a lot, so you can go through all of those and decide. Of course, yes, the school will be open, and your results will be given. And if someone is not satisfied with your results, you have always the optimal decision to review that is there for you, as well as you can decide. And if you decide that you continue with the A level, then you can start the class immediately as soon as the school reopens, inshallah. Okay. And then, because our next session will be starting, as you know, that September 1st. So by the time your result and everything will be in your hand, and then you can come to your conclusion with this. Okay, girls?
Yes, miss.
Okay. Inshallah. Next Sunday, I'm going to have a class with you again. So I want you to decide something, what we can do, and I want others' participation also. And you can tell me what we can do. Accordingly, we can proceed. Okay, girls? So let me leave my class today. Inshallah, we'll meet again next week. And I want all of you to stay well. And again, Shubha Navarsha, girls.
Shubha Navarsha, miss. And take care. Have a nice day.
Allah Hafiz.
Allah Hafiz.
Wa alaikum salam.